these two years were, seemed very interesting and very disappointing, because I became very aware of the difficulty of the enterprise. It was not something as simple as Piaget thought. Somebody with tools are going to put nice box where to put that, because most of the ideas were not themselves well defined. And therefore, how can you have laws about things that are ill-defined? Now, that, as a matter of fact, was the occasion of a paper of mine, which in 56, which I forgot for a long time, but now found again, and which brought back a stream of thinking. I became interested in the following bizarre question. Given that all those concepts in psychology, of economics, and so on, were extremely ill-defined, if defined at all, given that, how come there could be any law? So the question was not about how to explain observed laws in these fields, but how could there be any law? And I wrote this paper, which had the following theme. It said, before explaining, one must understand against which possible alternative one is explaining. If the power law distribution were found to be incorrect, could it take any other form? Would I have to explain its power law and not Gaussian or something? And so my argument went as follows. It was much developed several years later, but was very well written down in 56. Imagine you have quantities which are ill-defined, in which somehow different people report them in different ways. Take genera and species in taxonomy. Some naturalists would put a big genus with many species. Others would make several genera with fewer species. Very difficult to say one is right, one not wrong. Today, of course, we can, but we are dealing with old-fashioned taxonomies. So there were cases where simply some were making them bulky and not small. The cases where simply one put a genus just because somehow for symmetry and for beauty, a bit at random. Now, given all that, how come that this man Willis in 1922 found some very specific distribution of numbers of species within genera, a very well-defined power law distribution, which was a very great mystery? Now, that power law distribution had been explained by Yule as being the effect of evolution. But to me, that was not enough, because given that evolution is very poorly represented by the idea of species and genus, could there have been any other distribution, any other law applicable? I argue that not, that the only distribution which is in a certain sense invariant under what I call filters, which are consistent in adding, splitting, in averaging, in moving, in taking largest, all kinds of, how to say, observational filters. The only distribution one could ever obtain were power law distributions. Now, this is written very, very concisely in this paper, and that indeed is very, very great extent the idea which was underlying what physicists shortly afterwards started doing in physics, that somehow you must have small ensemble, bigger ensembles, and the same rules should apply to all these various groupings. And the rules not invariant under this renormalization would not be observed, because it would not be robust in a certain sense. Now, I started that in a totally different environment. Now, let me give you an idea about how this applies. When statisticians deal with distribution of firm sizes, when economists deal with that, they respect their colleagues in statistics who told them that you take the average size of a firm. And you have reports in this industry, that industry, the average size of a firm, so and so. This average very often is totally meaningless. The most extreme case is that of the gun dealers in the US. At one time, to become a gun dealer in the US, you had to pay $20. Therefore, anybody who wanted to buy a single gun and could do it a bit ahead would become a gun dealer and then buy from the wholesaler or the maker. Then the US, to control a gun, put a rather high, say $2,000, $3,000 fee to just become a gun dealer. Almost all the gun dealers did not renew their license. The number of guns sold by big dealers moved a little bit. So the one before, say, one quarter was sold by one chain. Before, after that, a bit more. But the average gun size was a numerator which was more or less the same, denominator which changed in the ratio of 1 to 10, or to 3, or to 4, I don't know. But the idea of an average size was meaningless. The average size of a city, are you going to take the definition of a commune in France, or a township, or of a school district in America? It's a very, very elusive notion. So there is, underlying all those, how to say, harder sciences, softer because they're just harder. I don't call them soft, I call them hard sciences. Yeah. The idea that somehow we don't have those solid numbers to deal. Take income. The initial data on which Pareto was looking were collected before income tax existed. Nobody had any reason for hiding income. Now, my income is something extraordinarily ill-defined. There's some money which I am spending which is not income, and other money which we declare income, even though I don't think it should. But I'm a good citizen, I pay income tax according to law. But I don't think that this number at the end, which I sign every year, has any meaning whatsoever. How come any distribution could apply to it? This is something which is very, very fundamental. It's not a matter of explaining ill-known quantities, but very specific ones. Now, this this idea, again, came first in the context of taxonomy, and later on, I generalized very, very broadly.